So today we have for you Shri Krishnapani K.C. Raju, who will be talking on the subject, the ocean of becoming and the oneness of being. It's going to be a talk for 45 minutes as usual, followed by 15 minutes of Q&A that Shri Krishnapani ji will moderate himself. Just a few protocols, please stay muted through the talk. We will be muting you, and all your question and answer questions can be put on the chat function. Krishnapani ji will be happy to go through them one by one. If you'd rather speak to him, yes, you can. After the chat functions are over, you can unmute yourself and you can talk to him and ask your question personally. All our earlier talks have been uploaded on the YouTube under Ritambara Wellness. And if you'd like to be part of our community, or if you think there is somebody else who might be interested to be part of this community, you can please post the phone number or email ID in the chat function and we'll pick it up from there. And we'll add you so that you can be appraised of all our forthcoming programs. So let's get on with the program and welcome, very warm welcome to Krishnapani ji as well, and for making all this effort for us every alternate week. Thank you so much, Krishnapani ji. Over to you.
Thank you, Beena ji. Thank you very much, and a warm welcome to all the participants to this program. The title of the talk, as I mentioned, and Beena ji has also announced, is the ocean of becoming and the oneness of being. Now, before we proceed further with the topic or the subject proper, one important factor which is to be considered by anyone who is seriously interested in what we would call as the spiritual dimension of oneself is as to how persistent are we and how are we truly serious about our pursuit? Because generally it is seen that we all have a tendency to have the best of both the worlds. This is something which is incompatible, actually. See, there is a world outside in which we are active, and there is a bigger world inside where the whole outer dimension is defined by the inner dimension of our own self. If we do not recognize that fact and focus only on the outside dimension part of it, then what happens is there will always be a conflict between the two. The inner and the outer, there will always be a conflict. We have to understand the connection between the inner dimension of one's own self, where we actually live. We live more within ourselves than in the outside world, but it appears as though that we are connected to the outer world in a much stronger way, and it is more a case of our responding to the stimuli which we receive from the outside world. In fact, it has been very clearly demonstrated that 90% is how we respond to the stimuli rather than the stimuli directing our life or controlling our life. So the inner dimension becomes much more important. Now, in the topic selected for today's talk is the ocean of becoming. This is a term, actually a translation of a Sanskrit term which is very frequently used in the spiritual literature that is available to us. It is what is called as the Bhava Sagara, or the ocean of becoming. Now, the symbology of this has to be understood as well as the reality of it also. The symbology of it is that an ocean represents vastness. It also represents what we call as great depth. Then there are these factors like what we call as the ocean has a mysterious dimension to itself. Then it has this quality of being both very daunting and at the same time very tempting also. Because the ocean is a repository of great wealth. You have to dive deep into the ocean if you are interested in the pearls. If you are interested in something which is to bring out something precious, you need to delve very deep into it. Then there is the other aspect of the ocean. We find that it is continuously moving. You never see the ocean as still. There are currents and currents and undercurrents, and you always see that there are great waves and lot of bubbles, lot of surf. This is something which constantly comes to the shore, and one who is watching this ocean also sees the ebbs and tides in the ocean, which rise and fall twice in 24 hours. There is an ebb twice, and then you also have might have discovered that on a full moon day, the waves are much larger and higher. So we also see this dimension, as I said, of ever-changing nature of the ocean. And at the same time, its unpredictability. How the ocean moves about, how the ocean goes about. You find suddenly that there is a swirl somewhere, and there is a, what are called as cyclones or tsunamis or great, spirals being formed because of the currents and the air and other things. And there is a great unpredictability about it. And along with that unpredictability, we have this, what is called as the devastating nature of the ocean. Very frequently, there are some places in the world which are constantly affected. Very interestingly, you see that on the east coast of India, there are a lot of cyclones which come very frequently and number of times in a year. But on the west coast, it is comparatively lesser. Because basically the expanse of water that is there, it can generate a lot of energy and gather a lot of force and then come and hit the shore. Now all this is what we see as the dimensions of the ocean. And there is a strong correlation between the ocean and what we call as our own life, which is what is represented as becoming. So the ocean essentially represents life, and we also see that it is repetitive in several ways. There's what is called as a recursive loop to the ocean. So you can see that it is constantly changing, moving, and then going about in a particular pattern. And the patterns keep changing, and there are so many unpredictable aspects to it. And all this, we can very closely correlate to one's own life. If we look at our life, we see these ups and downs and changes which we don't anticipate. And life sometimes, or most of the time actually, is unpredictable. We don't know what is in store for us in the future. Next moment, we don't know what can happen. But at the same time as the ocean, the life is also very tempting. We would like to live. We would like to continue and grow. And all those factors are there. And ocean is actually this representation of one of the elements, which is water. Water is the main source for life. Whenever you see scientists and technologists, when they explore the outer space and other planets and all, the first thing they try to see is whether there is any water on the planet. Whether it's the satellite like Moon or whether it's a planet like the Mars or anything else. See, the first sign of life is found wherever there is water. So water is the creative principle and life begins with water. Now, the more important point is all of us seem to be very familiar with this term called as life, but what exactly is life? If we try to question that and say what exactly life is, then we are, you know, stuck. We'll be wondering because we essentially do not understand what life is. Do we call our daily life, what we live, our activity as life? Because life is something unscrutable. In fact, life is what we are. Another term that is normally, the term that is normally used in Sanskrit is prana for life. Now, one thing which we need to understand about life is that the two factors which we need to distinguish, as one is life, the other is what we call as consciousness. The important factor to be noticed here is that in order to manifest life in some form, material base is required. Material base is required, and when that material base is vivified by consciousness, then we are able to perceive life. Then we are able to actually see life. So in one way, matter plus consciousness is what we can say as life. Because if there is no consciousness in a person or in anything, we would call that as dead, isn't it? So, as I said, one of the terms that is used is prana. Now, as long as this prana is there, the life in any form has value. Let us take our own case as human beings. As long as there is this life operating through this body, there is value to it. But once that prana goes, leaves the body becomes a burden. The body becomes a dead weight and it becomes something which has to be disposed of at the earliest. So what was functioning through this life, through this body, is what is called as the principle of life. This life principle is something which is very strange or very difficult to identify. We can actually say that these four or five factors indicate life. For example, birth. Birth indicates life. Growth indicates life. Reproduction indicates life. Decay indicates life. And death is also a part of life. And in between, we see that there are several modifications. In fact, in the scriptures, these are called as the six waves, actually. Shad Urmi and Shad Vikaras. There is a change. They talk about, because life also involves what is called as hunger, thirst. These are also factors and sustenance in some form, nourishment in some form. All these are indicators of life. But do we understand life per se? One interesting idea that is presented by Swami Krishnananda of the Divine Life Society. He is a very prolific writer and a very wonderful writer. There is a website called swamikrishnananda.org and the Divine Life Society. The beautiful, you know, he gives a lot of insights into several things. And when I was doing some research, I found a very interesting thing about his understanding and his, you know, statement of life. And I'll just quote what he's saying. He says, the entry of the universal into the particular is the juncture which is called life operating in our personality. So it is the entry of the universal into the particular. The juncture of that, he calls it as life operating through that particular. And further he goes on to say, it is the borderland of the infinite where the individual expands into the expanse of the infinite and the infinite contracts itself into the finite as it were. It's a very beautiful way of putting it, which needs a lot of pondering. These are some statements where I personally feel that one needs to contemplate deeply. Where he says it is the borderland of the infinite where the individual expands into the expanse of the infinite and the infinite contracts itself into the finite as it were. In fact, scientists have proposed this. They have said that there is a material sector and there is a cosmic sector. And they have found things like cosmic rays and what is called as the background radiation. They have found a certain radiation which is coming from everywhere. There is no particular point where we can say it is emanating from this particular point. It's coming from everywhere simultaneously. And it's there in the background always. And some of the theories talk about the cosmic coming into some parts of the cosmic coming into the material and some parts from the material going into the cosmic and all that. See, the same idea is reflected in what Swami Krishnananda says, that it is the borderland of the infinite, where the finite is transcending into the infinite and the infinite is contracting into the this. So this is a beautiful way of understanding life. Because if we give this larger dimension and larger perspective to life, then it becomes easy for us to comprehend several things in this world. For example, as I said, we also see the cyclic nature of things in the finite. Manifestation, however vast it may be, the ocean, however vast and however deep it may be, it is still finite. It is still limited. It still operates in a closed loop. If you are talking about the earth as one unit, everything operates in that closed loop to the extent possible. And as I said, this is what is called as the ocean of becoming. Because there is this transformation, modifications, constant changes happening, something becoming something else. And therefore, this idea of becoming goes into this whole process of life. And we find that it is cyclic in nature. And it operates within the spatio-temporal framework. It operates within that limited framework. relatively we are able to understand or consciously be aware of what we call as time and what we call as the relative distance between things. These are all scientific facts which are demonstrated. All this forms the ocean of becoming. And from this, we come to another important aspect where the term used quite frequently in almost all the Indian languages, because it is derived from the Sanskrit, which is called as samsara. Samsara essentially means that which undergoes something called as transmigration. Anything that undergoes transmigration, anything that is flowing and moving. And from samsara, there is another word which is frequently used in the scriptures, is also samsmriti. Samsmriti. Samsmriti means revolution, revolving. We are caught in this. We are caught in this whole thing of becoming, of transmigrating, of transmuting, transformation, keep on changing, but within the dimensions prescribed for it, because it is finite by definition. And therefore, the word samsara means the world, the life we lead in the world, and the worldly illusion. And then we have all dimensions. It is sometimes called as a forest, samsara kanana. Life is there compared to a forest, where if you get into it, you are lost. You lose your way. It's very difficult to find your way back. Then they use the term the prison. Life as a prison, because it is enclosing and binding. Karagruha. Then there is this term called samsara kupa. That means it's a well. You have simply fallen into a well and you don't know how to come out of it. So you see the beauty of all these terms which have come, they have come out of one's own experience. Somebody feels it's like a prison, somebody feels it's like a well, somebody else feels that it is like a forest, and somebody feels the bondage, samsara bandha. And somebody called it as a samsara vishavruksha. It's a poisonous tree. And somebody called it as samsara anala. That's a fire, because it's burning. You know, the distress, the dukkha, the paritapa, the heat that it generates. All these are expressions of various dimensions of the life in which we are stuck. Okay, that's why called as samsara sagara or bhava sagara. So this principle of becoming has to be understood in the context of one's own life. How is it that I am stuck in this? How is it that this has got this dimension of being involved, entangled, completely caught in it? Completely caught in it. At some point or the other, everybody feels this. As somebody, normally, if you don't feel like that, and if you feel life is good and happy and all that, then there is no problem at all. There's no issue at all. There's no issue at all. If somebody says, I'm happy, let him continue in that state. But does it last? It doesn't last. There is always some inadequacy. There is always something lacking. There's always something tempting. There is always something which you want more and more of it. You want a continuity of it. You want it to continue. You don't want it to break. So all these factors drive us to the great illusion, which is called as the world or the bhavasagra or the ocean of becoming. So the entanglement of matter and consciousness, as we mentioned, is what is perceived by as life. So this is what We also equate it to the term, as I mentioned earlier, called prana. This is an important factor. And the factor which helps us to be better in this world is the recognition that this life form, life which is flowing through me, is no different from the life flowing through anybody for that matter. The moment this deep conviction and recognition of this fact that life in me is no different from life in anybody else, whether it is human or animal or birds or insects or reptiles or whatever form of life, it is the same principle that is flowing. The recognition of this fact is the first step in the direction of the second term of my talk, which is oneness of being. The first step is to recognize this factor, the factor of the fact of life being common to all of us. Then what happens? Then the first thing is, as I'll come to one of the Upanishads which talk about these things in detail, basically that would mean that we will value life in any form and we would not like to hurt life in any form. This is a fundamental spiritual principle which has to be understood not only as a mere idea or a concept or somebody's opinion, but perceive this as the truth. Without this perception of this truth, we find that we are always in conflict. Me and the not me. Me being the most important and everything is subservient to me. This division, this conflict, this idea of exploitation flows from this being blind to the fact that life as a principle is universal and any embodiment, any form which is embodied, which has all the features of life, as we said earlier, of birth, growth, reproduction, decay, and death, and so on and so forth. Once we recognize this fact, then there is no issue of hurting anybody or causing damage or causing any problem to any life form. Otherwise, what happens is we will be stuck in the situation in which we are now stuck. Life, as I said, one of the factors is its unpredictability. We have been going on damaging it to a great extent and come to a point where a very small thing, somebody, I think most of you might have also received this WhatsApp message, somebody calculated what could be the total weight of all the coronaviruses in this world today. Based on some dimensions and calculations and all, they said it is hardly a few grams, maybe 1 or 2 grams. You see, nature has just released 1 or 2 grams of some life form which has disrupted the entire world. This was possibly like the last straw on the camel's back, which has broken it. So the first principle of our recognition of the spiritual dimension within us is this unity of life. The same life principle operating in every particular, the universal operating through the particular. Because then only we'll be able to maybe proceed further in understanding what that oneness of being is. One aspect of becoming, as we have seen, is life. When we talk about the oneness of being, we are talking about the unity of consciousness. And very interestingly, there is another beautiful symbol. As the ocean we have seen is a symbol and also a reality with respect to life as it operates. The other beauty of the oneness of being symbolized is what is called as the tattva or principle of akasha. Now, in some other context also, I think I have discussed this, but primarily look at it this way. What is akasha? Actually, we do not. Akasha is sometimes called as the space, sometimes called as the ether, sometimes called as the medium for consciousness and all that. But if you consider it from a very ordinary perspective of being space. Now, the space is unified, uniform, and a single entity. It is not divided. It has several, scientific features which they call as being isotropic. That means every unit of space is exactly like every other unit of space. If you are talking about units of space or dimensions of, relative dimensions of what we see as space. And another beauty is, everything is in space, but nothing touches space. Everything is contained in space, in the akasha tattva. But can anybody say that something is touching it? Whether it is ourselves or our earth or our solar system or the entire galaxy, you take the millions of stars and galaxies, are they, at any point of time, are they touching this principle of akasha? This tattva of akasha? No, they can't. They cannot touch it. But it envelops everything. And nothing can modify it. Nothing can change it. No amount of destruction or disruption in this entire process, which constantly takes place. Stars are born, stars die. They simply sucked into the black holes, and white dwarfs are born, and new stars come in. There are what in astrophysics they call it them as red giants and white dwarfs and black holes. You see all these terms. Huge, unimaginable amount of energy is released or absorbed, or the universe is found to be expanding at a tremendous pace. They have found galaxies moving away from each other at speeds greater than light. But does all this activity, does it modify or change or touch what is called as this akasha? So this is another thing which has been referred to in the scriptures, and when they say, and even the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Sri Krishna says, I am like the akasha. It is something, nothing touches me, nothing influences me, nothing can modify me, or nothing can bring about any change in me. And as I mentioned earlier, it is also considered as the medium of consciousness. Akasha is considered as a medium of consciousness. Consciousness flows through it. Consciousness operates through it. And the Vedas very clearly say, from Akasha, Vayu is born. From Vayu, Agni is born. That is, from the sky or the space, or what is called as this medium of consciousness, the whole creation has come forth by first the air coming into being, then fire, then water, and finally the earth. Akashat vayurajayata. So there's a whole mantra which gives this sequence. So that is the primordial substance or primordial element or tattva, where we find that it is oneness and it is infinite. And there is no question of any modification or change. And therefore, that state is what we call as being as compared to becoming. So this is another beautiful way of, symbolic way of putting it. And we see this oneness all around us. If we are perceptive, if we are sensitive, if we are inclined to observe things around us, then we find, as I mentioned, the first principle is the identification of the flow of the life principle in everything that is living. And it is the common principle flowing through everything. Then the second dimension is this dimension of oneness, uniformity, being infinite, being unmodified. Nothing touches it, nothing changes it, nothing can do anything to that. And everything proceeds from that. Now, the way of getting out of this cyclical and revolutionary system which is operating within the spatio-temporal framework and within the Kala Chakra. Time is also, for us, it's not linear like in the Western psychology or Western philosophy, where it is described as an arrow of time, as though it is moving from past to the present to the future. No, it's not like that for us. It is a chakra. It is cyclical and it keeps repeating itself. And this cycle sometimes becomes a spiral also. Upward or downward moving spiral based on the nature of the energy which is flowing through it, flowing through this dimension which we call as time. So therefore we see ups and downs. Therefore we see from a scriptural point of view, there is this increase of adharma and decrease of dharma. Then there is an increase of dharma and a decrease of the adharma. We have this concept of the yugas. And very famously, Lord Sri Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, whenever there is a decline of dharma, whenever there is a proliferation and expansion of adharma, or, where it becomes intolerable, then I appear. I appear in the sense nature has a system of bringing it into balance. So the recognition of these two factors, one on the life side, where we find that it is in everything that is living, it is the same principle operating. Therefore, when my life is precious to me, it should obviously mean that every life form should be precious to me. I would not simply cut a tree. I would not simply kill an insect. I would not simply destroy huge forests. At one time, the Amazon basin was said to be so big that it would take about 8 or 9 hours in a flight to cross from one end to the other end of the Amazonian basin. If an aircraft is moving almost at the speed of 800 or 900 kilometers per hour, you can imagine the expanse of it. And very interestingly, the Amazonian basin, the fresh water that goes into the sea there, a very interesting fact was told to me when I was in Brazil, where they said you can go almost 100 kilometers into the sea, and if you dip a bucket in the sea, you still get fresh water from the basin, from where the river is joining, the Amazon River basin is joining the sea. You go 100 kilometers into the sea, still you get fresh water. So imagine the amount of water that is going into it. And what is it that we have done? We've almost destroyed the whole planet simply by not recognizing this fact of the universality of the operation of the life principle. You know, one of the Sanskrit words for water is jiva. Jiva means life. One of the synonyms for water is jiva, that which gives life. So a principle which we are destroying is to be understood because we are not destroying something outside us, but we are actually destroying something inside us also. The same life principle is operating. So we are destroying that. Then, as I said, simple observation, which will tell us there is something called as unity, something called as oneness, and something which is untouched by this idea or this feature which we are calling it as becoming. That is the oneness of being. One is represented by the ocean, the other is represented by the sky or space. We have to recognize this principle of life and unity of life. There we have to recognize the principle of oneness, uniformity, being totally untouched by anything. So that is what should drive our life, our understanding of life, which will allow us to come out of this rut, come out of this cycle. Otherwise, we are compulsively stuck in this loop, compulsively stuck in what is called as samsara. As I said, whether you call it as a forest or a well, or whether you call it as something else, whether you call it as a fire or whatever it is, based on your own experiences, it is still the same thing that is operating. And we are creating that world for ourselves. And unfortunately, we are doing it for others also. We are not only creating this problem for ourselves, but we are also creating the same problem or aggravating the problem into the future. Now, just see, my nephew, who is about 5 years or 6 years, now he also frequently uses this term coronavirus, COVID-19 and all. What we have experienced maybe in our 50s, 60s, 70s, they are experiencing when they are less than 10 years old. Now imagine what kind of a life we are leaving for them. What kind of a life we have created for them? By simply not recognizing this fact of the life principle being the same everywhere and the same principle operating, and the other dimension of there being a state which is oneness, which is untouched by any of these activities of the samsara or the ocean of becoming. I don't know where I am running short of time, but I wanted to actually discuss a very important thing. See, we have a beautiful Upanishad called as the Chandogya Upanishad. In the Chandogya Upanishad, there is a particular vidya which is imparted by Sanat Kumara to Narada. Sanat Kumara is considered as a divine being, The Kumara term refers to a being who does not age beyond 16. They are always youthful and only 16 years. The appearance is said to be like that. And in another context, I have mentioned, if you see the picture of Narasimha Swami, you find that a small boy is standing in front, who is Prahlada, and there are two on the right side, two on the left side, again youth, young boys standing just behind or aligned with the Narasimha Swami image. These are the four Kumaras, called as Sanaka, Sanandana, Sanatana, and Sanat Kumara. I'll not go into that aspect of it because there's a lot of discussion that can, but Sanat Kumara is a realized soul. He's a realized person who knows the truth. And Narada goes to him and says, I know all the kalas, all the arts, all the sciences from the worldly point of view. They enumerate about 64 kalas or Chatushashti kala. The 64 kalas. Narada says, I have learnt everything. And he enumerates what all he has learnt. And says, with all this learning, I am still inadequate. I still feel something greatly lacking in me. There's something seriously wanting in me. Then Sanat Kumara gives a discourse to Narada. And in that, he gives to him what is called as a particular vidya, which is referred to as Bhuma Vidya. This Bhuma Vidya is something akin to this ultimate reality. In fact, the Upanishad itself says there is nothing beyond this Bhuma Vidya, and this is what gives you the great happiness and bliss. Yo vai bhuma tat sukham. This is a very interesting topic by itself, because there are several dimensions to this to this particular vidya. But I'll close with one important thing from that Upanishad, where there is a beautiful statement which says, ahara shuddhau sattva shuddhihi. Sattva shuddhau dhruva smritihi. Smriti lambhe sarva granthinam vipramokshanaha. Now, ahara is whatever we take in. Generally, the translation is given as food, but it's not food alone. Adi Shankara himself in the commentary on this Upanishad says, whatever we take in through all the five senses is ahara. That is the food. And that has to be pure. That has to be pure. Because, you see, purity as a matter of is also considered as a fundamental principle. There is a statement which says that purity is that which is compatible with the nature of the absolute. This is the definition of purity. Purity is that which is compatible with the nature of the absolute, the ultimate reality. So therefore, whatever we take in through our senses, that becomes ahara, and that has to be pure. With that purity, our inner being, the sattva, sattva means the antahkarana or the inner being, what is called as the manobuddhyahankara and chitta, or the mind, the translation of buddhi is sometimes given as intellect, the ego, and the consciousness functioning through this whole thing. This is called as the antahkarana, that is shuddhi. With that, that means with what you take in as ahara, if it is pure, that purity will give purity to your antahkarana or your inner being. And with that purity, what happens is your attention, your memory, it becomes stable. I would not translate smriti as merely as a memory. It is the continuum of attention. The term used by Adi Shankara is avichinna. Avichinna means that which is unbroken. So that continuity of that attention can happen when there are these two types of purity. One is the ahara shuddhi and then the sattva shuddhi. One is what you take in and the other is what you clarify within your own inner being, inner self. That clarity will provide you with this continuity of attention. And once that attention is stable and fixed, then all the knots of your life, all the knots which have bound you, all those things will get unentangled and you will become free. That is why he says, sarva granthinam vipramokshaha. Granthi means a knot. All knots are simply unentangled. And therefore, for a being who knows this oneness, for him, there is no problem, no issue remaining from the worldly point of view. And he is totally what we call as free. He is totally unentangled. Nothing of the world can affect him. Because all the knots are totally dissolved. They're simply dissolved. And that is the state of the oneness of being. So this is the quantum leap we have to take from the ocean of becoming to the oneness of being. If occasion permits, as I said, this is a very interesting thing about the Bhuma Vidya, where very sequentially the Upanishad dwells upon this subject, where Bhuma is no different from the Brahman. There's another interesting term, because Bhuma etymologically means plenum, completeness, wholeness. And the term Bhumi or the earth is also a derivative from this term Bhuma. And it is that Vidya which is liberating and which unties all knots and totally sets us free. And we experience, I would not rather use the term experience, I would say we would realize the oneness of being. Thank you so much.